All right.
Thank you very much. Layden was a healthy toddler who enjoyed exploring new things and following his cat Peekaboo around the house. His mother, Sandra, had heard about the dangers of too many vaccinations from her friends, but she trusted her doctor, and so she took Layden to get the recommended shots. Afterwards, Layden became more withdrawn and showed less interest in his toys, in his family, even in Peekaboo. Layden was diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder. Science says multiple vaccinations are safe, but Sandra's experience tells a different story. Scientific misinformation takes many forms, and one that's often blamed is storytelling. In my portion of this talk, I'm going to be giving a summary of the review article that Liz mentioned, so please take a look at that, that focuses on the science of storytelling. And I want to focus on four key points as I make a connection between science on the left and storytelling on the right. Key point number one, storytelling is inherently subjective. A story or a narrative is a message that describes some phenomenon through the experience of specific characters. And there are so many choices in how to describe that experience. Through whose perspective do you need to tell the events? What events do you even need to include? What character backstory do you need so people can make sense of the reactions that happen? There is no single correct story for a series of events. Or in other words, as if there could be true stories. Things happen in one way, and we retell them in the opposite way. Key takeaway point number two, science and storytelling mean different things by truth. Physics must eventuate in predicting something that is testably right, however much it may speculate. Stories have no such need for testability. And this is a fundamental difference between the purpose of either of them. The purpose of science is to transcend the particular and arrive at conclusions about the world that are empirically true. The purpose of storytelling is to make connections through human experience that provide interpretation and meaning to reality. And these purposes define truth very differently. Scientific truth is evaluated by its accuracy and its alignment with external reality. Narrative truth is defined by the lifelikeness of the characters within the story world. This is why even a completely fictional narrative can nonetheless give a truthful account of exploring some phenomenon. Point number three, this contrast in truth leads to scientific misinformation. Layden's story is an example. That is a human connection to science that accurately captures someone's experience and provides an interpretation that makes sense within the story world. It just so happens that it's not a representative case, and it doesn't align with what science knows about vaccinations. Narrative audiences are so focused on making connections and experiencing interpretations within the message that they're less focused on contrasting that to scientific external truth. Research finds that audiences are very poor at identifying incorrect information within narratives and often accept it as true. Audiences also tend to change their attitudes, beliefs, and even behaviors in alignment with the perspectives and interpretations given in narratives, often sometimes unbeknownst even to them. And this narrative bias is very difficult to counter with facts, with statistics, even with direct warnings. And because stories represent a particular case, people often extrapolate outward to come up with general probability estimates based on that case. Of course, because we know narratives are subjective, there's no need for that case to be representative. And in fact, often it is the more extreme and unusual case that makes for a more exciting story.
I want to tell you a story. 11 years ago, the New York Times broke a story about an ABC legal drama called Eli Stone that was about to premiere. The Times reported that the series' first episode lent credence to the discredited link between childhood vaccinations and autism. The news surprised the American Academy of Pediatrics, which called on ABC to cancel the episode. They said it could lead to a tragic decline in immunization rates. It also surprised me because of the work I do at the USC Annenberg School. I've directed a center there, the Norman Lear Center, since its inception nearly 20 years ago. It's a research center. We study the impact of entertainment on society. We not only study it, we also attempt to shape it. We try to inspire the creative community to consider the consequences of the awesome power that storytellers wield. In stories about public health, those consequences can be life or death. Hollywood Health and Society is the Lear Center program that focuses on health narratives and entertainment. We make it free and frictionless for writers and producers to get input on accuracy from experts. It began in 2001 as a partnership with the CDC and the Writers Guild of America. It's grown since to include funders like the Gates Foundation and industry players like the Producers Guild and the TV Academy. We've worked with virtually every network, studio, and streaming service that makes or distributes narrative entertainment. In just the last few years, we've consulted on more than 1,000 aired TV storylines. But despite our industry radar, that New York Times story blindsided us. So we joined the Pediatrics Academy in trying to persuade ABC not to air the episode. How did that work out? Here's what aired. In this clip, the manufacturer of the vaccine is being questioned about his daughter.
Your child's name, sir.
Jenna?
Did Jenna ever receive a flu vaccine?
Several, I'm sure.
Were any of them manufactured by Butel Pharmaceutical?
Objection!
Oh, no, now we're getting somewhere.
Well, Mr. Cook?
I believe the choice of vaccine was Jenna's pediatrician's decision.
Mr. Cook, do you recognize the man in the glasses who just entered the room?
That's Dr. Varga, Jenna's pediatrician.
Or as I prefer to call him, my next witness. Now, I'm going to ask you one more time, Mr. Cook. To the best of your knowledge, did Jenna ever receive a Butel vaccine?
No, she did not.
Was that at your request, sir?
Yes, it was.
8 million Americans saw that show. The most we could convince ABC to do was tack on this card at the end, letting viewers know how to find the CDC autism website. Somehow, that information doesn't pack the same wallop as a fictional jury awarding $5.2 million to the mother of that adorable boy. But there's a happy ending to this story. Just 10 days ago, on March 24th, the CBS political drama, Madam Secretary, aired an episode about vaccine hesitancy. This time, we knew about the storyline before the script was written. This time, we connected the show's writers to CDC experts. This time, instead of ending with a card, it ends with a star, Madam Secretary herself, Taya Leone, sending viewers to the UNICEF website. This time, the show's executive producer said, it wouldn't be artistically responsible to leave room for, oh well, maybe it's okay not to vaccinate. 8 million Americans saw that show too.
While storytelling can lead to misinformation, that's not the end of the story. So if you remember, I said there were 4 points I was going to make. Key takeaway point number 4. Storytelling also offers science a tool to combat misinformation. Because while storytelling is distinct from science, that does not mean it is deficient. Stories retain more of the surrounding complexity that scientific formats often discard, such as emotional meanings, personal conflicts. And in science communication contexts where those broader connections are valued, storytelling may offer great benefits. So for instance, instead of thinking of it as a versus, we can think of them working together. Science education is one context where storytelling is being used to teach these broader conceptions of scientific knowledge, to make help students make these connections between science and society and the metacognitive ideas of what science is and how it works, the nature of science. Similarly, entertainment education and narrative persuasion embraces the narrative bias to use it to help students build support for science viewpoints and audiences by showing how characters experience the science in ways that are accurate to reality and promote scientific goals. So while science and storytelling are fundamentally different in their evaluation of truth, their underlying goals are not that different. They both seek to make sense of the world and our place within it. And so by bridging the two, storytelling can help science provide meaning by incorporating accurate science into human experience. And this is something that's often needed. Jerome Bruner states, "Perhaps this is why tyrants so hate and fear poets and novelists and, yes, historians, even more than they fear scientists, who, though they create possible worlds, leave no place in them for alternative personal perspectives on these worlds." So whether storytelling leads to scientific misinformation or helps science to counter it depends on the story being told and who is telling it.
I want to tell you another story. Numbers is a crime drama that ran for 5 years on CBS. In its second season, the show asked Hollywood Health and Society for help with an episode they were working on called Harvest. The story involved the black market for organs in the US, which enables rich people to get transplants faster than ordinary people. At the show's request, we connected their writers to experts at the Division of Transplantation in the Human Resources and Services Administration. The experts told the writers that the US black market for organs is a myth. But shows and screenwriters are, of course, not obliged to be accurate. They may want to, or they may have other priorities. The only thing they're obliged to do is tell stories that get good ratings. Here's a clip from what aired.
Drop that scalp!
Drop it! The table. Turn around, put your hands behind your back. Frida?
Timmy, turn around!
Frida?
10 million Americans saw that scene. But there's a happy ending to this story, too. Numbers found the black market story too compelling not to tell, but the show's consultation with experts focused the writers on the truth behind the myth, the truth that makes the fiction believable, the worsening shortage of US organ donors. When an episode airs, sometimes there's a scene called a tag or a button at the end. Here's the button on the Harvest episode of Numbers. The stars of the show, the five detectives, are sitting down to supper.
Hey guys, sorry I'm late. I got stuck at the DMV.
What were you doing at the DMV?
Well, I'm now officially an organ donor. Check it out.
Hey, look at that.
Oh, what cool. Nice, huh? All right, so now I get treated with a little more respect around here.
You know, if more people took that simple step, can you imagine the ramifications?
Well, basic economic theory, black markets rely on a shortage of a regulated commodity.
That's right. Increase supply, the black market disappears.
Well, here's a couple extra applications in case anyone wants.
No, that's all right. I already got my sticker.
Yeah, look, I've been an organ donor for years.
Yeah, me too.
10 million Americans saw that scene too. Oh, there's a button on that button. 3 years after that episode aired, the Journal of Communication published this article, "The Power of Narratives: The Effects of Entertainment Television Organ Donation Storylines on the Attitudes, Knowledge, and Behaviors of Donors and Non-Donors." Among the findings, 10.3% of non-donor viewers of the Harvest episode of Numbers said that the program motivated me to become a donor. Even if only 1% of 1 million became organ donors, that ain't nothing. Thank you very much.